Let's start question time.
Yay.
Yay. Okay. So Jamie Hunsacker asked, can you guys talk about the underrepresentation of trans women main characters or love interests in lesbian fiction? So, Tara, we haven't come across many.
No. No, it's true. And I'm sure there is more that is happening outside of kind of our little realm of lesbian fiction. Because there really is, the thing that I've really noticed is that we have this set of publishers that I think, you know, they're putting out world-class books for sure. And that is like the Bold Strokes, the Ilvas, the Bywaters, the Bellas, the Sapphires, all of them. I'm trying to think of how to put this. It's almost like its own little walled garden of fiction that was shut out of romance writing very deliberately, which we learned about when the Romance Writers of America, RWA, when they had their gigantic blow up kind of in December of 2019, I think. Yeah, it was around that time. And there were some people who talked about how lesbian writers were very deliberately kept out of there. And so, you know, there had to be this flourishing on its own. And like NIAID was a press that was doing its own thing even before that. And so there's like, there's this, our little area of publishing. And then there's like the broader romance publishing, where there haven't been many lesbian stories at all in mainstream. Like, it's happening now more. And we've seen, you know, Something to Talk About by Meryl Wilsner. I want to say Hang the Moon, but that's the second book and it has a man and a woman together. So Written in the Stars by Alexandria Belfleur, which is also a fabulous book. Olivia Waite has put out a few now in her Feminine Pursuits historical series. But there are definitely, like, I haven't come across any there either, except for Roller Girl by Vanessa North, which I haven't read yet, but I've heard really good things about. And so I have to think that if there are trans women in lesbian fiction, it's elsewhere in more of like the literary fiction realm.
Right.
But that's, I don't spend a lot of time in that particular swimming pool, so I don't see it. So I guess, Jamie, what I would say, first of all, is 100% you are correct that there is a massive underrepresentation. We're starting to see some inside characters.
Right.
Jay had one in Wrong Number, Right Woman. I always have to slow down when I say that book title because I want to be like, wrong woman, right? No, no. Right woman, wrong. No, no. So it's, I think it's Wrong Number, Right Woman. I hope it is. I'm so sorry, Jay, if you're listening. I'm such a jackass. So Heather is a side character in that book. And Jay has said that she's writing a romance for Heather, which I'm quite excited to read. And I know that Jay is very careful when she is writing outside of her lane. And so I am hopeful that she's going to work with some pretty great trans sensitivity readers to turn out an excellent book. But in terms of like, even getting to books that are written by trans women, I don't know where they are. They're definitely not coming out from our publishers. And I'm not really sure why. I don't know that it's fair for me to say. I don't have insight into what the publishers are writing. I don't know if it's a welcoming enough and a safe enough space. For the most part, I can only really speak kind of from my experience as a genderqueer, kind of bisexual, pansexual woman in this space. The genderqueer part doesn't faze anybody. That's no big deal. Every so often, where I catch problems is that like bi, pan kind of, and I use the two for myself. I feel like either fits equally well for who I am. And the people who have a problem with that also tend to be people who are transphobic in our community. And so while it is a small group, it is occasionally a very vocal group. And so I guess I question whether trans authors have felt safe here.
That's a good point.
I don't know that there has been enough of a deliberate effort on the part of the publishers to try to source more of these books, to try to acquire more and to publish them. I think there is a certain level of openness, but to me it's kind of similar to the whiteness problem that we have in our corner of publishing as well, because it is very, very white, and there are some women of color who are writing, some Black women and Latino women, but it's been hard because I also know Black women who have left the lesbian world because of racism in our part of this end of publishing. And so I'm trying to figure out how far I want to go with this. I think it's something that the publishers need to take a hard look at and see how can we, like, as they are trying to be more inclusive of Black and Indigenous people of color, how can they also be more inclusive of trans women? Because their stories are absolutely essential too. So I do think the publishers need to kind of take a hard look at their lists and who do they want to be acquiring and how can they go out and specifically make space for that and make sure that they, not only that, but like, do they have editors who are going to be able to provide that kind of competent feedback? Because you also want to make sure that there's safety and care throughout the whole process. Unfortunately, I don't know how much is going to change until then. I mean, Karina Adores, which is they're an LGBTQ imprint of Harlequin. It's not lesbian, but they're finally, they've just announced that they've acquired a romance with a trans woman leading character, which I think is very exciting. And I hope that we see more of it. So I guess that is my call or challenge back to whoever is doing the, you know, acquiring editors. And if there are any agents or anybody like that that are listening to us, that absolutely, we need more trans women. You know, we don't get to where we are now with the rights that queer people have, especially in the US. You don't get there without all the work that trans women were doing.
For sure.
Like, trans women of color were at the forefront. And so, yeah, please, more stories. I want to see them. And actually, specifically, if you know of any that you've read, Jamie, or anyone else, if there are any that you can recommend, please send those recommendations in. You can tweet at us individually or to the podcast handle. You can DM us. You can send an email to podcast@queerlyrecommended.com. But I definitely love to read more. So
I think that a lot of the publishing companies have really made a forward movement for more diversity. Mm-hmm. I can see that within my own publishing company. And I feel like at least my editor, Ashley, she is very aware of everything because she worked with kids, queer kids. Boy, that's hard to say.
Yeah.
Queer kids, you know, at the school. And so there's a lot. She is very, very good about sensitivity as far as how things are titled, called, represented. Like, sometimes she'll say stuff in my books, like, you can't say that you cannot say this. And I'm like, really? Mm-hmm. You know, cause it sounds like I could say that, but I think that there are, she's also really young too. So she's, because of her job and because of who she is, she's like really into just the whole entire world. And so I feel like it's like we're a big machine. You know how like you're a tanker on the ocean and you have to stop and like veer. It's going to take a little bit of time to stop and to veer into a different direction. But I feel like we're getting there. I feel like we will have some more, maybe bigger steps into the trans community as far as books and representation. And I feel like we're kind of sort of getting there. We're maybe taking steps. Maybe. I'm hoping.
I think we need to see the publishers actually like I said, I think we need to see them deliberately seek it out. I know Bold Strokes has previously published books with trans characters, not necessarily trans women. I can't remember.
I know there are a lot of trans women. men, but I cannot think Dina of Hankin. Trans women. Yeah, yeah, Dina Hankins for sure. That years ago, she's been like very supportive and very, and has written a lot on trans men characters.
Yes. Which I feel like is almost its own can of worms, because, you know, we see that in certain like TERF spaces where they're very welcoming to trans men talking about how, you know, they've basically been lied to and bullied into it and blah, 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 which is absolute bullshit. But then, of course, don't want trans women in there for their own very TERFy, horrible reasons. All of that garbage about wanting to invade women's spaces and whatever, like 100% you can miss me with that nonsense, because it is not a thing. That's not, no, fuck off. Just like fuck off and then continue fucking off. So I guess in case people haven't noticed, our feminism is very intersectional here, and that is important to us. So yes, I want more books. I personally am not sure how to find the best books, the books that people love and what they trust. I will also admit that that is an area that I also need to work on, because I haven't done as much seeking it out as I should. I tend to read what comes to me for review, but that is an area that I would like to be better. And so if anybody has recommendations that they'd like to pass on, one other book that I do recommend that I really loved was Femme Confidential by Naren Holtz. It's a Canadian literary, takes place in Toronto. And there are basically three leads in it. And one of them we see kind of going through the transition process as well. And so that's, we see before and after. And it's just, it's overall, I forgot how much I love character-driven literary fiction, especially Canadian. There's just this, it just has a really specific vibe. Canadian fiction has a really specific vibe to it that I don't even really know how to lay out. But once you read like five of them, you know what it is. It's so good. But hopefully, Jamie, that answers your question.